Hello, everyone, and welcome to A Course in Miracles with Miracles One. And we are in our second episode of Just Beginning the Text. That's what we've been doing. So you can pick up your book and join with us as we do this. And first of all, let me say hello to my co-facilitators here, Gayle Bartlett and Mary Dole.
Hello, everybody.
Hi, everyone. So happy to be here.
And this is Rev Deb, of course. I don't think I even said that at the get-go, but whatever. Hopefully you know who we are based on if you've been listening before. But if you're new, hey, welcome. Thanks for joining us in that. So last time we got started with, we read the introduction to the text. And then we only got as far as about the first five miracle principles in chapter one, section one, Principles of Miracles. And what we've been doing is we read for a little bit, and then the three of us stop and we talk and share, well, what's coming up for us and you know, in relation to what we've read, what we've learned here. And sometimes we share personal experiences and that sort of thing. So here we are. We're ready to go. You ready to go? Yeah, we're ready to go. Okay. So I'm going to read 6 through 10, and then we'll pause and then we'll see what's coming out. I mean, these are kind of like short sentences in the sense there, but who knows? You know what? Maybe I should read through 15. Yeah, you know what? I'll read through 15. I think that'll give us a little bit more. So, alrighty, so here we go. Number six. So these are chapter one, section one, the Principles of Miracles. And we are looking now at number six. The miracles are natural. When they do not occur, something has gone wrong. And number seven, miracles are everyone's right, but purification is necessary first. Number eight, miracles are healing because they supply a lack. They are performed by those who temporarily have more for those who temporarily have less. Let me read that again. Miracles are healing because they supply a lack. They are performed by those who temporarily have more for those who have temporarily have less. Number nine, miracles are a kind of exchange. Like all expressions of love, which are always miraculous in the true sense, the exchange reverses the physical laws. They bring more love both to the giver and the receiver. Number 10, the use of miracles as spectacles to induce belief is a misunderstanding of their purpose. And number 11, prayer is the medium of miracles. It is a means of communication of the created with the creator. Through prayer, love is received, and through miracles, love is expressed. Number 12, miracles are thoughts. Thoughts can represent the lower or bodily level of experience or the higher or spiritual level of experience. One makes the physical, and the other creates the spiritual. So number 13, as I flip my book here, miracles are both beginnings and endings, and so they alter the temporal order. They are always affirmations of rebirth, which seem to go back, but really go forward. They undo the past and the present, and thus release the future. 14, miracles bear witness to truth. They are convincing because they arise from conviction. Without conviction, they deteriorate into magic, which is mindless and therefore destructive. Or rather, the uncreative use of mind. And number 15, each day should be devoted to miracles. The purpose of time is to enable you to learn how to use time constructively. It is thus a teaching device and a means to an end. Time will cease when it is no longer useful in facilitating learning. So there we have 6 through 15. Now let's just remind ourselves, well, what is a miracle? A miracle is a shift in perception, right? It's a shift from fear to love. So that's what we're talking about here. We're not talking about water into wine or anything like that at all. We're talking about shifting our minds, because remember, this is a course in changing the mind, right? Healing the mind, and not a course in behavior. So with that being said, I'll kind of pass the ball here and let's see what else comes up for us.
This is Mary. I think the thing that occurs to me as I listen to these is the idea of peace, of bringing oneself and those around you to peace. If you shift your perceptions from fear to love, then obviously you're going to be in a state of peace. And when he talks about purification, I remember when I first read the text long ago, and it said, miracles are everyone's right, but purification is necessary first. And I thought, what the heck does that mean? I mean, purification, is that some kind of ritual or something I have to undergo? I don't think so. I think it just means remembering and listening to the inner teacher. Changing my focus from the everyday sort of way I perceive things to a more loving, appreciative, peaceful kind of way. I think that's, to me, that's what purification means. And yes, I do think I understand about not using them as spectacles. I'm not even sure you could, because everyone who has a shift in perception from fear to love, they've already had the experience that leads them away from the spectacular. It kind of leads you to the calm inner part of you. Anyway, that's kind of the way I see it. And thank you. I'm done.
Well, Mary, that was a lovely summary. Thank you. As Rev Deb was reading them, I was thinking about the way I was brought up and a very traditional Christian background as a Protestant, and my three sisters and myself, which I've talked about before, went to church faithfully every week and participated in youth fellowship and sang in the choir and did all those things that families did back in the 50s and 60s, really. It wasn't just our family. It was every family who had any commitment to religion in any form. And I must say that with the sermons I listened to, and we had a minister who would preach, I mean, we're young kids, and would preach for an hour. It would be an 11 o'clock service, and we'd get out of there at 12:40. And we're all wiggle worms. But anyway, he talked in terms of the New Testament sense of miracles. So it's just amazing when you hear sermon after sermon or homily after homily and whatever they might call in the Jewish tradition in any form. It's having difficulty with reading this, as Mary said, a long time ago, and really fully understanding it. So I bought Ken Wapnick's book, and he dissected each one of the miracle principles, and I found that very helpful when I had committed to the course. But basically, what I'm understanding is exactly what Mary said about miracles now. In the workbook, one of the discourses in the workbook, I think it says, when it's what is a miracle, miracles do nothing. They just undo. And how many years, speaking of prayer, because Jesus references prayer in the 11th principle, prayer is a medium of miracles. And the way I understand it is that as long as I'm devoted to my own practice with the Course in Miracles, I really don't have to worry about whether I understand it or not. It's getting to a place of peace and making peace a priority, so that, as it says, And the sixth principle, when they do not occur, something's gone wrong. If I'm not in a state of peace, I'm going to be aligned with the ego, and I'm going to see what I can get unconsciously or consciously from a situation, as opposed to the ninth principle, where Jesus is basically saying, if I'm in miracle mode and a state of peace where I want this for everyone, if there is someone in my life, professionally or personally, who is rattled or nervous or upset or uptight or ticked off with someone else, I can sit there peacefully and he or she will receive that peace even if I say nothing. That's what that means to me. And he emphasizes, he uses the word temporarily twice. I may have temporarily more than the other person who is temporarily less. However, unlike a miracle that Jesus demonstrated in the New Testament, which was the emphasis by all these people who recorded what he did, it was the person has leprosy, the person is healed of leprosy or comes back from the dead or whatever. But the bottom line is, this is something that we have to apply all the time. It's not like a miracle of healing that we're familiar with in the New Testament, which is strictly of the physical body. Although in one of those, and then I'm going to stop talking, and one of the incidents that's described, the woman who had been almost stoned and let he who cast the first stone be without sin or whatever it is, he said, go and sin no more. So he did address the power of the mind to affect one's behavior, even though she may not have understood that that's what he was doing. So just understanding, I guess the bottom line for me now is, how can I be more peaceful throughout the day? And what does that mean? And if I make peace my number one priority, then miracles will happen organically. I'm done.
I like how you ended there. Yeah, exactly. If peace is my priority, well, then it will unfold. Right, exactly. I was just talking about that yesterday with our study group here. Same thing. Steps to freedom. Which I did over the weekend for our Sunday teaching video, is same thing. I own it and I forgive it. There's a lot more steps in between, but basically that's how I can have freedom. The one that I was looking at was 12, which miracles are thoughts, and thoughts can represent the lower bodily level of experience or the higher spiritual level. So our thoughts are what are powerful, right? We have the ego thought, or we have the loving thought, the thought with God, the thought with the Holy Spirit. So knowing that it's a matter of changing my mind, changing my thoughts, is how I can perceive differently as well. So let's see if there was anything else. You know, each day being devoted to miracles, well, you know, we want to shift our perception, right? That's what we want to do. Certainly would feel better, right? So let me go on. Okay, so 16.
Excuse me for interrupting. I think it would be helpful for me as well as our audience to speak to principle 13, where Jesus says miracles are both beginnings and endings. Mm-hmm. When I first read that, I was very confused by it. I didn't understand it, and if you would like to elaborate on that, that would be very helpful. I mean, he really does wrap that up in the principle, but that may be a little elusive to people who are new to the course.
Okay, so let's read that. So miracles are both beginnings and endings, and so they alter the temporal order. They are always affirmations of rebirth, which seem to go back, but really go forward. They undo the past and the present and thus release the future. Well, I think the last part of that is really what tells us.
Absolutely.
You know, what it's about, because it collapses everything that I believed before, you know, while I was in the fear mode. So it's like, oh, I could have had a V8, you know, sort of thing. Yeah. It's like, I realize I have a realization. And so it just collapses all of that. So there's nothing to relate to in the past, because now it doesn't exist. Whatever it was like, well, I can't touch the past, right? You know, I'll put my fingers in the air. Those who are listening who can't see me, it's like, you know, well, I can't touch it. There's nothing tangible about it. It's in my mind. So if I shift my, you know, if I'm stuck in the past, well, then I'm in the fear. But if I change my mind to the present moment, you know, with the Holy Spirit's help, of course, I'm here. I'm in the moment. So that whole past stuff doesn't even exist. It's gone. Right?
I have an example. And tell me if I'm wrong, because I'm more than willing to be wrong. Just a quick example and we can move on. I've been married forever. Many, many years. And my relationship with Bill was very much a special one, where there was a lot of fear on his part, fear on mine. And as I've become more miracle-minded or right-minded or less wrong-minded or more peaceful, it has been a new beginning. And the specialness that characterized our relationship for many decades, many, too many decades, has ended. Not that there aren't hiccups that arise, because they do, but I'm more committed than ever to a new beginning, which I can commit to every single day, every single hour, every single minute. So that's the way I interpreted it too. The old relationship has been reborn in form, where there's much more gentleness and tenderheartedness and kindness, as opposed to what it was before. So I don't know if I'm right about
it. I think that's a great example.
Okay.
Right? Because you've healed the relationship in the mind.
Yeah.
We're still healing, because, you know, we still have conflicts and things that come
Absolutely.
Up.
Absolutely.
Like, it happens to Paul and I too. But if I look at it where we are now compared to where we could have, you know, where we were or could have taken a different trajectory, is no, it's more peaceful.
Yes.
Because we haven't made the past as important.
Right.
Right? We're not stuck on that.
Right.
It's like, no, let's have a different kind of relationship. And as you said, a new beginning. And we can have new beginnings every moment.
Absolutely.
It doesn't matter what's going on, what's occurred. It's like, I can have a new beginning in anything. You know, in looking at myself and looking at a relationship. I mean, it's usually what we're either doing, right? We're looking at ourselves, or we're looking at relationship to something, yeah. Someone, in some way. And can I see this now from a place of peace instead of the fear? And, you know, and when we look at fear, you know, we have to remember we're looking, it could be anger, it could be judgment, it could be criticism, it could be terror, it could be sadness, it could be depression, it could be any of those things, not just. You know, when we say fear, we have to remember fear is like the umbrella, you know, and everything is coming underneath that umbrella, all these different emotions. So when I say fear, I'm meaning, well, it could be any of those colors of fear,
yeah,
if you will, in that way. And so it's like, well, where do I want to be? Do I want to be under that fear umbrella? And is it really keeping me dry, so to speak, right? It's not. It's not doing anything for me. Or would I rather be out in the sun, S-O-N, right? And know the light and know what is within me and know that, okay, these things can happen in relationships and in the world, but it's not what I really want.
Right.
Right? And that's where it is. Just like the course of a day, right? The sun rises and the sun sets. So even though it's a seeming beginning and a seeming ending, it's really all seamless too, if you think about it. in that way too. But, you know, here we are. We want to affirm what is true. What is true, right? We're not going back into the past. We're also, and then the other part is that thus releasing the future. So we're not looking at whatever the trajectory is. We're not looking at, well, where is this going? Right? We're looking at, well, what is now?
Yes.
And then what is now? And then what is now? Instead of, okay, where is this heading? Where is this going? See, that's the ego thought system where it wants to plan the goal and where are we going with this, et cetera, in that way. And there's nothing wrong with planning. There's nothing wrong with making decisions. It's when we are on the fear part of that, that really can, you know, constrain us. But if we could do that from a place of love, from a place of peace, you know, like I've made some decisions recently, business with somebody who was, I was doing business with. And it's like, well, I could see that I was uncomfortable. I could see that I needed to make some boundary decisions and some parameter decisions, which I did. It was not accepted very well. And so from there, it's like, well, I could go, well, this, you know, this is where, and, you know, and then of course the ego comes in. I'm not going to lie and say, oh no, like I was like perfectly okay with this. It's like, no, you know, the ego came in. It's like, well, where is this going? Do I want to keep seeing this person and that? But then you have to go, okay, spirit, what would you say? And spirit would say, end the relationship. And that's what this, and that's what I received. And so that's fine. Relationships are going to end. We don't have to hang on to them to hang on to the past. They're going to transform. As I told my group yesterday here, is that we don't know what anything is for.
Right.
You know, we look at this whole idea of holy encounters, and sometimes we're, you know, in a relationship with someone for a short time. Sometimes it's a long time. It's there for a learning purpose. It's there what to help us do shift from fear to love, right? It's there for the miracle. The miracle, that's what it's all about. So let's let Mary jump in too if you have anything too.
You know, all this reminds me very much of the holy instant, a timeless time, a time when everything comes to together into one, as you said, Deb, seamless time. I remember a couple of years ago, I had an experience of that when I have a guide dog, and I had taken him for his annual exam, and the bill was much larger than I could pay at the moment. So I said to the receptionist, "Is it okay if I pay it in installments?" And she said, "Oh, sure. I've known these people for 20 years. So they're very kind to me." So I went home and I was a little worried about it. I thought, I really would rather have paid the whole thing now, but I couldn't. So I sat down and I suddenly felt very peaceful and calm. There were birds singing outside. It was a winter day, February, and there were all these winter birds outside the window. I could hear them, and I happen to love birds. So I sat there enjoying them. And a little while later, the phone rang. And it was the vet's office. And she said, "I just want you to know that your bill has been paid." And I said, "What?" She said, "Yes, somebody heard you talking to us. And she decided, or the person, I don't know if it was a man or a woman, decided to pay the bill for you." And, you know, they didn't want me to know who it was, and I didn't ask, because I realized that the person wanted it as a gift, and I realized that this was a miracle. It was a shift in from fear to love. I had let go of the fear for the most part. I'd gotten calm, and as a result, or because of that, I was able to experience this generosity from this person who I don't know, and I bless the person every time I think of it. So miracles can happen in many different ways, and they certainly do abolish time. I'm done.
just one thought. The amazing thing is, Mary, it's not as though you were praying to be rescued.
No, I wasn't.
You weren't. You accepted that it was a hefty bill, and you were going to pay it off, and you handled it with grace. And that's the difference between what many people, the way in which many people pray. It's for things to change, for people to change. I did it too. No, there's no question, out of ignorance, not knowing. I must say, though, just real quickly, that there are times when there's something going on in my family or Bill's family or with Bill and me. Let's say there's a physical malady and I'm worried about it, that I do want to pray for that person to be healed physically. And there are many times I've had to stop myself and just pray for the highest good for that person. However, that it gives me an opportunity to work on getting beyond appearances and getting beyond form for what is truly going to be the most helpful for that person. And that's the purest form of purification insofar as a prayer is concerned, is to just say, you know, your will, God, not what I want, to assuage my own fear. I'm done.
Exactly. So before, you know, we're kind of starting to run out of time here, so I'm just going to read 16 through 20, and then we'll, you know, just kind of have a little talk about that, and then we'll wrap up for today. So 16, miracles are teaching devices for demonstrating it is as blessed to give as to receive. They simultaneously increase the strength of the giver and supply strength to the receiver. 17, miracles transcend the body. They are sudden shifts into invisibility away from the bodily level. That is why they heal. 18, a miracle is a service. It's the maximal service you can render to another. It is a way of loving your neighbor as yourself. You recognize your own and your neighbor's worth simultaneously. 19, miracles make minds one in God. They depend on cooperation because the sonship is the sum of all that God created. Miracles therefore reflect the laws of eternity, not of time. And then 20, miracles reawaken the awareness that the spirit, not the body, is the altar of truth. This is the recognition that leads to the healing power of the miracle. And so there we have those ones there. So a service, I think that one was sticking out to me. It's a service, a way of loving your neighbor as yourself, and you're recognizing both simultaneously in that sense, because when we come into that place where we want to, you know, we don't want to be in the fear and the conflict and all of that and say it is another relationship, that sort of thing, like what I was experiencing myself with this business person that I was dealing with, it's, well, you know what, if I hang on to the angst and all of that, what does it do for me? It doesn't do anything for me, right? It's keeping me blocked energetically, for one. So if I say, well, you know what, I did yesterday, because it was actually happening in the middle of study group, believe it or not. I had a text message because I use my tablet I use my book, my actual book, but I use my tablet over at the studio. I have the course on Amazon Kindle app, and I got a text message right in the middle, you know, on my screen. And it was this person, and I won't get into any details about it, but it wasn't like comfortable things being said. It was like, okay, I see where your mind is right now. You know, and I could have a sense of pity, but what does that do? You know, this person being in victim mode, blah, 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 as Gayle would say, blah, blah, blah. I use it all the time. Yeah. But love, if I come to seeing that, so what I started doing was something I read long time ago in Marianne Williamson's book, A Return to Love, was, as I bless you and I release you to the Holy Spirit. So that's what I kept doing, you know, in between. You know, I was listening to people talking in that, but whenever I felt like the you know, it started to rise in my mind. It's like, you know what? No, I bless you. And I release you to the Holy Spirit. I bless you and I release you to the Holy Spirit. And, you know, after several times, you know, after it, you know, the whatever, the judgmental thoughts or whatever thoughts came up, it started to help kind of soothe that. And it's like, well, no, that's what I really want. And because of doing that, remember, we don't know, which we will learn if we haven't read one of these miracle principles yet, but we don't know what it does for another person by our own shift of mind. And so I think I would rather bless than curse in this situation. So that's what I have. So I wanted to, I don't know if Mary, you wanted to go or.
Yeah, sure. The same principle stood out to me about loving your neighbor as yourself, because you are both worthy of love. And I have found more and more as I practice the lessons and tried very hard to be, you know, put them into my life, not just like an abstract thing, but as, you know, means to help me through difficulties and in the peaceful times too. It really helped me understand that, you know, what I remember when I was younger, like Gayle, I grew up in a Christian family, and reading that the Sermon on the Mount where he says, you know, love your neighbor as yourself. And I used to think that was rather selfish. You know, I used to think, what do you mean love my neighbors myself? I mean, I'm supposed to be selfless and not worry about myself. Well, now I finally, after many years, understand that to love myself, my true self, not the ego self, but the self that God created, not the self I made, is helping everybody. Is helping the people that I contact day and day, the people I meet casually, and so forth. So yeah, that principle stood out to me as well, Deb. And thank you. I'm done.
Boy, Mary, that's so true. But you know, Rev Deb, I credit her with emphasizing that the last couple of years, the power of self-care and doing what we need to do throughout the day as often as possible to be peaceful, especially if we're agitated. And as Rev Deb was talking about this situation, a lot of times when I mow the lawn, if I'm agitated with anyone or myself, I use lesson 161, which I absolutely love, which is, give me your blessing, Holy Son of God. And the statement that Jesus provides toward the tail end, it's the second to last paragraph on page 306, if anyone wants to look it up who watches this, it's, give me your blessing, Holy Son of God. I would behold you with the eyes of Christ and see my perfect sinlessness in you. And that's really what Rev Deb was talking about with this individual from whom she got a text during her study group. And then where it's principle 18, a miracle is a service. It is the maximal service you can render to another. It also speaks to 16. Miracles are teaching devices for demonstrating it is as blessed to give as to receive, because we're giving, which speaks to, and I just lost it, the principle number 20, miracles reawaken the awareness that the spirit, not the body, is the altar of truth. So we're doing this inner spiritual work, this inner mental work. We're dealing with the thoughts that are coming from our own mind that are causing us to react to something outside of ourselves and do the interpretation or the judgment, which has caused some malaise of some form. Or to Rev Deb's point, fear, that umbrella of fear, and it can be anger, it can be rage, it can be depression, it can be anxiety, it can be any one of the plethora of emotions that fall under the category of fear. So if I'm not in peace, I'm in fear. It's really very simple. I'm done.
Indeed. If it's not peace, it's something else, right? That's the bottom line. Here I go. You know me. I like the bottom line. If it's not peace, it's something else. So what, I could have peace instead of this, right? It's my choice. All righty. So we got through Miracle Principles 6 through 20 today in this podcast episode. So join us in our next episode in about 2 weeks, and we'll go from 21 to however far we go. It's nice to just kind of have these conversations and just kind of talk about it where, you know, we don't have to get through any certain number when we're doing this. So I hope you are enjoying listening to us and joining with us. And just remember, the website is MiraclesOne.org, where you can find all the resources that you need, mostly free, audios, videos, et cetera, articles in relation to practical application of A Course in Miracles. And we have a study group here in Madison, and Gayle and Mary actually facilitate an online study group on Wednesday afternoons at 1:30 Eastern, 12:30 Central Time in the afternoon. You can find out more information on the website about that as well. So thank you once again for joining with us. And as always, we wish you much peace. All righty.